And welcome back to this special edition of Weekend Today. It is 6 a.m. in Australia, 9 p.m. here at Buckingham Palace, where the Royal Standard is flying above the palace, meaning the King is in residence as we speak, meeting with leaders from around the Commonwealth. Right now, though, you're looking at live pictures from inside Westminster Hall, a steady stream of mourners still passing through to say their final goodbye to the Queen, as they have done day after day and will do for another 30-odd hours. A little earlier, it was a scene of an emotional tribute. Her Majesty's grandchildren standing vigil by her coffin, led by Prince William and Prince Harry. The ceremony, an incredible sight for mourners who'd been on their feet for hours. A little earlier, the King and Prince William showed their appreciation for those in what's being known as the queue, shaking hands and chatting with those in line. The King also met with Commonwealth leaders here at Buckingham Palace, including our own Prime Minister and our Governor General. But between all the meetings, all the pomp and the pageantry, it's easy to forget that this, the centre of all of this, is a family that is grieving the loss of a relative and matriarch. Princesses Beatrice and Eugenie captured it best, releasing their moving statement this morning, saying, "We've not been able to put much into words since you left us all, our beloved granny." Marching down marble stairs, the world's most famous brothers together again, putting aside their grievances to grieve their grandmother, who was loved universally. The Prince of Wales, his brother and his cousins, the next generation of royals, paying their own respects. The haunting tribute honouring a woman who meant so much to so many. Dressed in black, with heads bowed, the 15-minute vigil, a mesmerising sight for those who'd queued for hours. Behind the coffin, Prince Harry stood solemn and silent. The decorated Duke dressed in his official military uniform for the first time since stepping back as a senior royal, granted special permission by the King to mark this historic occasion. From the heir to the throne to the youngest, just 14 years old, his parents watching closely in the wings. Just as suddenly as they appeared, the young royals marched out. A heart-wrenching show of support for the Queen they all called Granny. It was solemn and silent and so touching, and Christina Hearn is live in Westminster, where earlier today the King and Prince of Wales met with those that were queuing to see the Queen. G'day again, Chris. It was a total surprise for those in line.
It was a total surprise, unannounced. Nobody knew that they were coming out, but what a wonderful gesture and wonderful surprise for everyone that had been queuing. I mean, by the time you get here to Lambeth Bridge, it's 10, 12, maybe 14 hours. So by the time they got here, they're nearly at the end. They've still got to go over Lambeth Bridge and get into Westminster Hall. But that is when these lucky people in the queue met King Charles and also Prince William, who turned out. They shook hands with the mourners. They talked to them, saying that the late Queen wouldn't have believed the sheer amount of people that have turned out to see the Queen's coffin. To the well-wishers.
30 hours, no sleep.
You're 30 hours?
Yeah.
You're a very good 30 hours.
What do you think about the royals turning out today to meet everyone in the queue?
Yeah, no, I think it was really good, especially if so many people are waiting for so long. It's good to let them show that they know that we're taking the time, and so they are too.
What, I mean, it must be such an incredibly hard moment for the royals, King Charles and Prince William, but they are taking the time to meet the public.
Yeah, I guess they know that they're being watched as well, so they know that they're on camera, but also it's something that we can look up to, and seeing them doing that.
Now, how long have you been in the queue?
Since 12:30.
So about 9 hours?
Yeah, it's been okay. It's gone by pretty quick.
So you've got, do you know how much longer? You've got probably about 2 hours, 2 to 3 hours.
From yeah, like three and a half maybe.
And has it been worth it? Or is it going to be worth it?
Well, hopefully. Yeah, it's been good.
But why have you decided to do it?
Well, I guess it's kind of like a part of history. We might not have this opportunity again, obviously. Like, didn't really have many other plans this weekend, so I thought might as well queue up.
And it's been a good feeling in the queue?
Yeah, no, there's very good camaraderie, good spirits.
Well, we wish you all the best. We'll let you get your spot back in the queue. Thank you so much for speaking with us. I mean, this is the fourth night that I have reported on this queue. And can you just believe just the thousands and thousands of people that just keep on streaming through? At some stage, of course, Charles, officials are going to have to make that decision. Just when do we cut this queue off? I am told officials will make that decision tomorrow morning because not here, you guys will get through. Some people are a little bit concerned they'll cut it off now. They won't. They'll make that call sometime tomorrow because they have to make sure that everybody in the queue gets through before the opportunity to see the Queen lying in state at Westminster Hall closes very early on the day of her funeral. Charles?
A beautiful shot there, Chris, with the Westminster Palace and Big Ben behind you as well. It is a jovial and jubilant line that then becomes very solemn at the other end, but great to see you down there this morning. Well, away from those crowds and the big crowds, Commonwealth leaders, including our Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese, were given their first chance to meet the King. Mr. Albanese labelled the occasion a great honour.
An opportunity for me to express my personal condolences to King Charles, but also condolences on behalf of Australia.
Justin Trudeau and Jacinda Ardern also meeting the King. Mr. Albanese will meet with the new UK Prime Minister, Liz Truss, as well. But earlier, our Prime Minister and Governor-General made their way to Westminster to visit Queen Elizabeth the Coffin in the Westminster Hall. Anthony Albanese and David Hurley paying their respects in a few moments of silent reflection. Mr. Albanese also visited Lancaster House, where he signed the official book of condolences to Her Majesty. And plenty of children have joined that queue over the weekend. One royal fan lucky enough to meet King Charles and Prince William. And it's safe to say his emotions may have got the better of him.
It was amazing. It made my heart fall out.
The kid's about to become a star here in the UK. And Nine will have live and comprehensive coverage of Her Majesty's funeral. It begins at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6:30 Central and 5 p.m. on the West Coast tomorrow afternoon. Bring in Royal Commentator Camilla Tominey, who's here. Camilla, this was around 6 o'clock local time. Complete silence, but completely mesmerising.
It was. I couldn't take my eyes off it. And I think some of those who have been queuing literally for hours, almost a day, must have been completely flabbergasted by what they were seeing. Because to see actual royals, particularly William and Harry, together in uniform, but also just the poignancy of the moment. Look at Zara Phillips there bowing her head. All of the grandchildren, all eight of the grandchildren, who had such a good relationship with Granny, as they called her, all in their own unique way. I just thought it was very, very moving. I mean, we've seen a lot of extremely poignant and touching scenes, but that really surpassed what we've seen as well this week, I think.
It humanised it as well, because while the Prince of Wales led it, as he will as the heir to the throne, you had the side of James, the Viscount Seven, and then you also had him sitting next to his oldest cousin, and like the age gap there, 44 to 14, it shows the breadth of that generation.
Absolutely. So, yeah, James, who doesn't really do that much public facing, he's only 14, he's still in school. His older sister, Lady Louise, is a bit more used to being in public. And he's shown maturity beyond his years there. But there is that big age gap, because people forget that the late Queen obviously had two of her children in quick succession, then waited a decade to have the next two. And actually, her relationships with her grandchildren reflect that age gap. When William and Harry were growing up in the 80s and 90s, they didn't see as much of Granny because she was touring around the world, coming to Australia for 6-9 months at a time. And actually, when the Wessex children were growing up, because they were that much younger, they did see a lot of them at Windsor Castle. I remember speaking to staff saying, you know, they used to step over tricycles in the doorway because the Wessex kids were there as toddlers.
Yeah. We saw at the request of Prince Charles, King Charles III now, that Prince Harry was wearing his military uniform. Why do you think the King pushed for that?
Well, To be honest, when we saw that scene unfold, wouldn't it have looked odd if he wasn't in his uniform? You actually had the two brothers there leading their cousins, not just as the older cousins, well, I say the older cousins, Peter and Zara are older, but as the senior cousins in the pecking order. But weren't they also leading them in their kind of former military guise?
Yeah.
I felt that they should have both been in uniform. I thought it looked lovely that they were both in their Blues and Royals uniform of a very similar ilk. And actually, I had written a piece early in the week saying I thought it was a bit of a slight, you know, the idea that the Duke of York can wear his uniform for that particular vigil, that aspect of the funeral, and not Harry. To me, it seemed a bit petty and unnecessary. At the end of the day, Harry has served in Afghanistan twice. He's seen active service.
Yeah.
And just for the optics of it, I think the brothers there needed to be dressed equally for this.
To be honest, there's the rank of captain, he wears the most military medals as well. It makes total sense that he would do that. All right, let's talk about the King and William's moments. They met the public at what's been known affectionately here as the queue.
Yes.
It's become almost a pseudo party group experience, life experience down there, and this caps it off.
Well, we've got the queue and then we've got the queue for the queue, which
yeah,
is known
exactly.
as the QE2. but the point, how British can you be, by
exactly
the way?
Right.
I mean, we literally queue for anything
stare
around
patiently.
The clock. And this was kind of impromptu, but why wouldn't they want to do it? I think they want to recognise the fact, and William said this, you know, that the late Queen would be so touched to see how much of people's time is being given up to pay tribute. The crowds here obviously loved it because it was completely unexpected. And what's interesting, I think, about walkabouts these days, Charles, is we get so close to them. In the old days, as a reporter, you'd be there with your notebook trying to listen in. You can't hear anything because you kept at a distance. Everyone's got their mobile phone, so they're filming it. I think earlier one woman could be heard, her father had phoned her just after she'd met the Prince of Wales, and she's going, "Dad, Dad, I can't speak. I've just shook Prince William's hand." So I think there's this aspect of the public really appreciating how much FaceTimes the royals are giving at a time when, let's be honest, if it was an ordinary person, you or I, you'd want to be hiding away if your granny had died and or your mother had died, and here they are facing the public every day.
It's one of the difficult aspects. I know that Prince Edward has come out and said that he will not shake hands at the moment. That's part of his process. I mean, you want to be accessible, I guess, as a monarch and a royal, and that's clearly been an instruction from the new king. What's that about?
I think that's simply a result of him saying, look, I want to get through as many people as possible, and shaking hands takes up time. And also, I think he said to some of the well-wishers earlier, look at all of you, if I shook all of your hands, I'd be in agony. He won't be the first royal to say that.
No.
I mean, we know that the late Queen obviously used to wear white gloves almost as a kind of to protect herself. And it's exhausting, and it actually hurts if you're shaking that many hands. He and Sophie were out. Sophie, the Countess of Wessex, who, again, she's very much won the public's affections because, frankly, she's had grief etched across her face all week.